How are you? How is everybody? Everybody well? You doing all right? I'm doing all right. Welcome. Welcome to the automotive stream. This stream will some of you guys have seen this stream before, and the regular viewers will know that you hear me talking about it all the time when we're playing Kerbal or Cities or anything else. Or my summer car. Freaking piston. Hopefully we don't do that here. But, well, under the Twitch Creative tag, you can stream working on cars. So, that's what we're gonna do. I have a truck ready to go, and by ready to go, I mean it's in pieces. I'll show it to you momentarily. And we're gonna try to fix it. Twitch fixes auto cars. That's what this is gonna be. It's gonna be fun. It's gonna be a fun thing. But today, what I'm mostly showing you guys, what I mostly want to show you is the truck, what we're gonna do with it, and basically, we need to compile a list of things that need to be done. There's a lot of things, to say the least. Yeah, there's a lot of things. So I have, in the true roadkill fashion, I have a piece of cardboard and a Sharpie, and we're gonna write down everything that needs to be done on this truck today, and we're gonna kind of compile a list and figure out what we need to get done. I have a feeling that the list is not gonna be here or here so much, but all the way down there and possibly going on to the other side. Yeah, this truck, it needs a lot of work. It needs a lot. Yeah, it needs a lot. So, let me bring you guys up to speed, and I don't want to mess up these glasses, so don't freak out. What we're doing is, I'm going to take them off. I know, and I'm going to put on these. These are the auto streaming glasses. I know, I look weird. I get it. I understand. But here, this is really going to get you. No headset. So, because it's going to be pretty tough to do anything with a headset on and sunglasses in my garage, mostly because it's dark out and I have like a lot of lights in here trying to get this place nice and bright. So, this is what we're going to do. So, with that being said, let me introduce you to Freb. Oh, by the way. Oh wait, do we have two cameras? Oh yeah. Excuse the overlay down here. That's still a work in progress, I guess. But I did change this around a little bit from the last time we did this during the test stream. Now the webcam is actually on the tripod. You can see it right here. And the GoPro is the one that's mobile this time around. So I can give you nice clear pictures via a nice here. Check this out. You want to see cameraception? Watch this. Look at this thing. Ready? Oh, let me switch back over. And this is the GoPro mobile streaming camera that I tweeted about a second ago. You can see I zip tied it, true roadkill fashion. We also have a flashlight, tactical flashlight, held in that also holds the wires in to and a mobile battery so the battery can last longer. So we have this. This will work, I guess. Hey, David with the 3 month resub. I don't have headphones on, guys. It's going to be really hard for me to hear updates and stuff, and I don't want to put them through a speaker. That will feed back into the microphone. So if you do have a resub or anything, I do appreciate it. Also, it's a little harder for me to catch up with the chat this time around. I do have my iPad with me in case I need to look at the chat when we're like under the truck or something if I'm showing you guys what's going on. But it is going to be a little bit tougher to do that this time around. But we should be, we'll make it work. Is that an extra zip tie for no reason? No. I actually had excess zip ties on it, and then I tried to zip tie here. I'll just show you. In the picture that I tweeted, I tried to zip tie the flashlight to the GoPro, and then I figured out that you could just mount it on the wires. And look at this, little GoPro tripod, battery zip tied to it for extra long lasting. This thing is fully charged. This is fully charged. This should give us about 4 hours. And then if we flip into split screen, I have a C920 just on a tripod. I have my lighting, my snowblower. Wait, what's that? Hold on. There's Fred, by the way. I'll show you in a second. What is this? It's Greg. He wrote his name on. He learned how to write. The chair learned how to write. Do you see that? Oh man. So Greg will be back. I'll be using him for purposes unknown in here, down here. So I still have the old chair. That was my streaming chair for upstairs for the longest time until my back decided that it didn't like that chair anymore and I had a back spasm. That was a good day. All right, cool. So you can see, here's the rig set up. I have a custom bracket. Hold up. Ready? Boom. I have a custom bracket that I made mounting an encoding rig and the keyboard and monitor with a surge protector are all bolted right to this toolbox. You're interrogating him. I'm doing nothing of the sort. So, I have all the tools, move my cardboard list, ready to go. Look at this. This is what I've been doing to prepare all this time. I come down here in the morning, usually, and work on this. See, I have a fan for keeping it cool. I don't think that's going to be a problem today. Mr. EJ just came in. I don't think that's going to be a problem today, so... Shall we get started? Here, I'm gonna turn the light off so it's not like... You're a plumber, okay? Thank you. All right, so before I really get into this, is there really any questions? I'll switch back over into mega webcam view. I also disabled the GoPro auto shut off, so we don't have to worry about that this time. Is that an old IBM? I have a Model M keyboard and an LG 15-inch 4:3 display. It's what I had lying around. If this takes off, I'll get better hardware, except for the Model M. We're keeping that. Listen to this. Ready? Will there be shop music? I don't know. It really depends on if I can get some music. I mean, I could throw some Rebel Galaxy on, like we usually do. But, yeah, I'm not sure. I have a very important question for you. How are you doing? Great. This reminds me of a last job in the bicycle shop. You're making a list, checking it twice, going to check out what's naughty and what's nice. And Edmanda with the 10-bit tips. Once again, the notifiers are going to be because I don't have any sound. I don't want speakers so I can hear it, and I don't want it feedbacking in, and I also don't want to wear headphones because it's not a good idea. Maybe I'll figure out a way to do like a wireless something, whatever. You look like a dad that rides bikes for a hobby with those glasses. Thank you. These glasses are a little weird, but they're also really cool because, they have lights attached to them. That could be useful for later. Anyway, you look so different. I know. Here. All right. Well, for now, I'll go back to this, but I'm telling you, I can't see anything down here. I can't see nothing. Here, I'm going to try to turn on the lights. It's also extremely cold down here, but hopefully the lights can fix that. Get the sauna going. Oh, sauna. All right, so. The Freb. This is our 1959 Ford F-100. It's in pieces, very similar to summer car. It has a lot of work. We need a lot of work to get this thing done. I'm gonna flip over into the split screen here. We have a lot of work to do with this. If you notice, give me a second. If you notice, we got no engines, Ted. Do we? A couple of Nissan SR20s. We'll pull a premium right before Race Wars. SR20, that's a good joke. Ow. That was my foot. The floor jack. But anyway, how's the weather? It's cold. So Freb is powered by a small block Windsor Ford engine. This is a 4.9 liter or 302 cubic inch small block Ford. It was called the 302 in the 60s, and they switched it to the 5 liter in the early late 70s, early 80s, more early 80s. Its actual displacement is 4.99 liters. This is, as far as right now, this is bone stock. This is a bone stock engine. It's out of a 79 F-100, stock cast iron heads. It's got a hydraulic flat tappet, I believe, cam. Stock cam, it's junk, it's garbage. For what we ultimately want to do, it's garbage. But hey, whatever. I'll start doing engine work when the engine is over there, inside of the car. Because Freb is undergoing a swap, a suspension swap. This is the suspension. Here, hold on, let me get the light on. This is the suspension out of a 2007 Ford Crown Victoria. This is what's called the Crown Vic swap. And a Crown Vic swap is basically an independent front suspension that you can, with some minor modifications to the frame, you see the frame's been boxed over there, and those fittings have been welded to hold the bolts together, to hold the subframe in. With some minor modifications to the frame, you can actually drop one of these in. I still need the trailing arm brackets fabricated, but that's the story for another day. See them right there? This stream is mostly just to give you a kind of introduction to Freb and kind of go from there. That Crown Vic front suspension enables us to... Here, hold on. Put that back over there. The Crown Vic front suspension enables... I started to do the swap for a couple of reasons. Because you had nasty bump steer with the first... with the original front end from 59. That was no good. So I changed it up. I wanted to change so I could get a smoother ride. The ultimate goal for this truck is, for right now, is, well, just to get the thing running. Don't get it right, get it running. I learned that from pretty much everybody that is even remotely a car guy. And I made that mistake with this truck. I took it apart, and then all my spare time, I was doing a restoration on it. We did the bed. I wish I could have streamed that. You can see the bed behind me. I painted all that right there myself with some rattle cans in the driveway. And an impromptu, and an impromptu paint booth made out of a couple of like pop-up tents and some fans. It came out pretty good. So I did the back of the truck. The back's pretty much good to go, but we do need to do the front. Unfortunately, right when I took the whole front of this thing apart, the stream started to get big. So I was working and streaming, and that took up all my time. Now that it's just back, I'm just streaming, even though we stream for like 10 hours. We have time to do this, and Twitch thankfully said it was okay to do. So that's the biggest thing. So now we can just stream working on it. Stream the restoration. Thank you. I sneezed. Thank you for everybody saying bless you. So that should be good. Here, let me switch back over. This should be fun. So now I'm going to kind of get into the list. of things to do, we do have a great deal of work to do. Building a car up and modifying suspension is not something that I would recommend anybody, any novice or anything doing. I took it apart when I was a novice because I'm an idiot. I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't even try to do that now with all that I know. If you want a little bit of background about me with cars, I just started tinkering with them when I was in high school, did high school auto shop, and that's about it. I've been reading about them ever since, just like space, you know. Cars and rockets. That's what I'm all about. And speed parts and bacon. And beer. Beer's good too. Anyway, so eventually this is gonna turn into the Truman Show. Jeez, I hope not. Yeah, I'm just gonna have stream cameras live, just mounted on my shoulders at all times. That'd be terrible. This is like an American Mighty Car Mods. Sure, why not? So, can we make this a rocket truck? No, I don't want to do that. I don't think it'd get very far. A truck probably doesn't have a lot of delta V if I put a rocket engine on it. It would have great thrust to weight. That would be really nice. But the delta V, low wet mass. The fuel tank would be kind of small. It's only what, a 19-gallon tank? We'd need to produce any significant amount of thrust with this thing. The rocket engine would need to have what? I don't know, 100, 200 kilonewtons, something like that, to move this thing, to have nominal TWR. So we have higher than one. Actually, you know what? We don't really need high TWR. It's just, Oh, now you've got me. Let's get back. Let's focus. Okay, so. Time for the truck. Let's go. Here we go. I'm gonna switch to the GoPro standalone, and I'm going to mount the light back onto it because I took it off there. I'm gonna move the camera over here. I made kind of a little mount for this thing on using some oak blocks, and we should be good to go from here. Let me just frame that shot. Okay, so. I'm gonna turn some of my floodlights on so we can get some better lighting. There we go. All right. So you can see the front end is right here. Once again, I want to switch to an independent suspension because of a smoother ride. I want this thing to just cruise. It doesn't necessarily need to go fast yet. You know, I just want to, get it back on the road and get it running. You can see the Crown Vic front end allowed me get these sweet bullet Mustang wheels for it, which is pretty sweet. Those are pretty cool. Those are off of an 06 Mustang. I bought them on Craigslist because you can find anything on there. Okay. So I think what I'll do is kind of go through what is needed to get this thing running. This thing needs a lot of work, mainly in the motor mount fabrication department. That's like the biggest thing right now. Right now, I have motor mounts that I bought. You can buy a kit for a 302 swap. This is what it is right here. And it comes with a pipe here. And basically, you fit the engine, right? You fit the engine in, you bolt this to the engine. That's part of the upper mounts. This bolts to the stock 302 upper motor mounts. There's two parts to a motor mount. And then you lay the engine on there and you tack weld this in place. And then you take it off and then you weld it. Problem is, I might have some clearance problems because, well, the 302 is a fairly big engine. It is a pushrod, so pushrod V8s are actually, I mean, kind of small, but it is a V8. And I do have a lot of room up front with this car. Problem is, I don't have a lot of room up against the firewall. I don't know. Let me check the screen to see if you can see. I have the transmission mocked up in there. But the transmission where it is. We might not have enough room. And if we don't have enough room, we're gonna have to take these and kind of make it so we can slide the engine forward. And that could be a little bit of an issue. That kind of killed this project dead in the water. I might need to fabricate up new motor mounts, or find somebody that can do it. I don't have a welder that's strong enough to weld box deal like this, but I'm sure we could find somebody. Back over there. Ugh. So, light. Okay, hold on. My floodlights, they're powerful. Powerful lights. So, that's what kind of part of the biggest reason why I haven't really been working on it. It's going to take a lot of engineering to get this done. That's not necessarily engineering. It's more, you know, well, I suppose it is. There's a lot of stuff that we have to take into account. The center of mass, weight distribution on the front cross member to make sure that the 302 is, well, doesn't snap it in half. That's an old engine over there. Here, I'll angle this so you guys can see it a little bit better. This is an older engine with a cast iron block and cast iron heads. They tend to be this thing that we don't really deal with in Kerbal too much. It's heavy. Has a lot of weight. So we have to make sure that, I think the crossmember can take it. It is aluminum, but we also have to figure out, you know, drivetrain geometry, which is kind of a big deal. Slip yoke distance, you know, getting, if we need to, change the crossmember mounts for the transmission and slide the whole motor and transmission forward. We're going to need a different drive shaft, so that means we need the drive shaft balance. We have to worry about the slip yoke in the drive shaft. You don't want it moving too far forward or too far back. If you don't know what a slip yoke is, here, I have the drive shaft. Give me a second. I think I may have put it in the truck. Hold on. Yep, okay. The drive shaft's in the truck. Give me one second. We'll switch to the other camera and I'll show you. Okay. So, let's go down under here, and let's take a look. So, right there, that's the front of the drive shaft, and you can see that piece, that cylinder piece that goes into the aft housing on the transmission. Let me just make sure you guys can see that. Yeah, okay. Yeah, you can see that just fine. All right, that's a slip yoke. And whenever you have a live rear axle, and what I mean by a live rear axle is that thing. See that big solid piece of metal? That's a Ford 9-inch rear end. Anytime you have a solid axle like that, the axle on the suspension, on those leaf springs that are right there, those are going to pivot because the suspension is going to make the rear end go up and down. Because it does that, the slip yoke is designed to slide in and out of the transmission. It's not supposed to slide out too much. You don't want it to slide out too much because then you're going to puke transmission fluid all over the ground. We don't want it too far forward either, because then if you bottom out your suspension or your suspension travels up, it's going to push the slip yoke into the transmission, and then you're putting stress on the cross member, on the transmission cross member, which is right there. See that bar? A little rusty under here, by the way. And subsequently the motor mounts. We don't want to do that. That's bad. So we need to make sure that when we mock this engine up and when we go to finally mount the thing, that the slip yoke has a nominal length of travel. Basically, I don't want it too far out. I don't want it too far in. That's bad. Either one is bad. That's too far for a slip yoke right there. See that? The reason that that's too far is because the transmission isn't mounted to the engine. The transmission is kind of like this. It's kind of hanging down because it's not bolted to anything. So the slip yoke is, because the transmission is hanging down, slip yoke sliding out. So we're gonna need to fix that. But that comes from mock-up and fabrication and all this other fun stuff that we get to do.